Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our book talk this morning. We are very pleased to have you join in with us this morning. Before I turn the mic over to our presenter, I would like to bring your attention to a few of the upcoming activities we have planned. On December 16th, we will have another book talk sponsored by the Mental Health for Activists workshop. That book talk on December 16th, that's Monday, December 16th at 7 p.m. Eastern. The book focus for that book talk will be Alienation, Marx's Conception of Man in Capitalist Society, written by Bertel Ohman. So, Monday, December 16th at 7 p.m. Eastern, we will have a book talk sponsored by Mental Health for Activists workshop on the topic of alienation, Marx's conception of man in capitalist society, written by Bertel Ohman. Then, as our presenter will share with you this morning, we will continue a discussion of this book, Historical Materialism, on December 22nd at 11 a.m. Eastern. Lastly, I'd like to bring your attention to our National Marxist School Online, which will be held in January and February. We are deciding whether or not to launch on January 18th or January 19th. There are several activities that may be planned for January 18th. So we may shift the start date to January 19th. The point being, please mark your calendar and plan to participate in the National Marxist School Online in January and February. We are building up our undergirding so that we can face the tasks upcoming with as much strength as we can muster. So without any more delay, I'll turn the mic over to our presenter this morning, Danielle. Danielle, you have the floor.
Well, thank you, Dee. Hi, everyone. Hello, my name is Danielle Francisca. I am a member of the Communist Party USA based in Detroit, and I'm very excited to talk with you all today about this super pertinent and fascinating subject matter, and specifically this book published. I have the version published by International Publishers, which really breaks everything down with regards to, as its title, Historical Materialism. But first, a bit about me. As I said, I live in Detroit, Michigan, and I was born here, but I've lived around the Midwest in different areas. And eventually I went to school at Wayne State University, where I studied history of art and visual culture. Then later on, I went to study at the University of Michigan. When the pandemic hit, it was really hard for me to find and keep my job in the arts. So I was picked up by an IT firm, and I've been working in IT ever since. So I hope to bring some of that perspective in both of this presentation and the part two that we have coming up in December on the 22nd, where, you know, today I'm looking forward to presenting on the topic, and my goal for the presentation today is to introduce it and focus on a primary key concept of historical materialism. I'll be looking at capitalism today, and we also will be looking at some art to make it a little fun. And then on the 22nd, you know, we can have more of a deep dive in the role of the working class today during this historical moment. So looking forward to presenting on this, having read this book throughout the election, and then now presenting on it weeks after the election. It's a really interesting position to be in. And I think we're all kind of in that interesting position right now. I mean, whether you're looking at headlines every day, you're talking with your family at dinner, your coworkers on the job, or even just the everyday struggle of, you know, our livelihoods and trying to keep our heads above water. It's a really interesting time. And I think that now more than ever, attending a session like this, where we talk about historical materialism we discuss with each other, but also all the other sessions that Dee has mentioned. It's really important to try and build up that repertoire and get that education going, because I think that we could do really good things moving forward and trying to combat the issues that we're facing. So without further ado, let's get into it. So the author is Viktor Afanasyev, and he was a Russian writer prolific between the 1960s and 80s in the USSR, a period during which he wrote more than 20 books and helped make Marxist education more accessible. He wrote a lot on history, philosophy, the economy, and he was editor-in-chief of Pravda, which means truth, and that was the newspaper of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. He also served on the Communist Legislature and then later on served in the Parliament. This is my first book I've read by him. His writing style is very much, he's very thorough with the concepts and really helps to kind of break things down, and I've really appreciated learning more about historical materialism through his writing. So what is historical materialism? I think this line, which is one of the opening lines from the Communist Manifesto, is one of the best lines to kind of describe historical materialism, which is the history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggles. So if you're familiar with material dialectics, then you can think of historical materialism as the application of material dialectics to history, and with two main concepts applied to history. First, the various phenomena of history are interconnected rather than, you know, the belief that they're singular independent events. And then second, it is the material conditions within which we live that lead to ideas and movements, which in turn will shape our material conditions. So this is also contradictory to the Enlightenment period idea that it's our ideas that first come and then shape our material conditions. Rather, what we see through historical materialism is that it's the conditions which inform our ideas and our movements, which we then take action upon to, again, shape our material conditions. So historical materialism is a scientific approach to analyzing and understanding the growth of humankind, with the main principle being the mode of production defining the course of development of society and all of human history. And by there's going to be lots of terms maybe that we'll throw around, but I think, you know, the book again breaks these terms down, is really great at doing that. So by mode of production, we mean the means and relations of production which go into producing material wealth and all which is necessary for humans to live. And by means of production, again, we mean the machines, equipment, tools, production buildings, transport, and so on. And relations of production, we mean the relation of people to the means of production. So the ways in which wealth is distributed and society divided into classes is dependent on what is produced, how it is produced, and how products are exchanged. So the final causes of social changes and political revolutions are the drivers of history, are changes from the modes of production and not the ideas of society, of how society should be, as we mentioned. So here are the various terms, and this is not an exhaustive list. I listed out, I think, some of the really basic ones. But again, the book is really great at pretty much dedicating a paragraph to like each term or like a chapter to entire concepts. So it's super helpful in that way. And we won't really be going through all these. We'll touch on them, but I think this is more discussion based and just kind of, you know, an introduction to some concepts. So the main point of historical materialism, what we learn from it, is that the working people are the real makers of history. We are trying to change our conditions to be better for us. And one of the main concepts under historical materialism, kind of the cornerstone of it, is this concept of the socioeconomic formation. So as stated earlier, historical materialism tells us the change in the mode of production which drives history, and it comes through the form of one socioeconomic formation taking over from another. So the socioeconomic formation is the totality of the phenomena and processes relating to the economy, ideology, family, way of life, etc., based on a historically determined mode of production. Society develops through the natural replacement of one socioeconomic formation by another more improved. So throughout history, we see different socioeconomic formations, you know, arise and then be taken over by another. And in the book, Afanasyev goes through these at a pretty high level, a lot more detail than I have on the slide here, but this slide is very high level with what we see. And so going from starting with the primitive society into slavery and then to feudalism, and then from feudalism society transitioning into capitalism, in which we see the mode of production change from artisans and small workshops to an industrialized workforce with large-scale factories, plants, mines, etc. And the relations of production also change from feudal ownership, in which there was this relationship between the feudal lords, or, you know, the feudal lords to their modes of production in which they owned, and the relations of the serfs to those means of production and the means of producing as well. While, you know, they had their own lives, they were free with their own lives, they were still subjugated to having to serve the lord upon whose land they lived. So the relations of production changed from this to that of private capitalist ownership of the mode of production, which is owned by a minority, and then now the free workforce is the majority. And that concept of free, I can elaborate on that. So while under capitalism, a worker has a sort of freedom that, you know, is different than it was under feudalism, they have freedom in their livelihoods, meaning workers are not obligated to the land nor to any particular factory. They are free in the sense that they can go to work for any capitalist. However, they are still not free from the capitalist class as a whole. So, since under capitalism, the working class does not possess our own means of production, we are compelled to sell our labor power and thereby come under the yoke of exploitation, as Afanasyev describes it. So this is the core of the class antagonism between the working class and the exploitative capitalist class, right? And within the capitalist formation of society, we also see the rise of monopoly capitalism. We see it take root and capitalism grows into imperialism. These are, again, kind of bigger concepts that have been broken down by Lenin, especially on imperialism, in which we touch on briefly in the book. By we, I mean Afanasyev, not myself. He touches briefly on these in the book. But yeah, capitalism grows into imperialism, of which the main feature is the domination of monopolies. And essentially, imperialism has intensified the exploitation of workers domestically as well as abroad. And with imperialism, we can think of capitalists dividing up the world among themselves and intensifying this exploitation. Thus, we see class antagonisms between the working class and the capitalist class become greater and greater as the capitalist class not only increasingly appropriates the material wealth produced by the working class, but the working and living conditions of the working class domestically and abroad become increasingly disparaged. So the working class sees themselves becoming increasingly exploited while seeing less and less of the fruits of their own labor. While that's happening, they become more and more resistant to the ruling class. And this is the deepest contradiction of the capitalist mode of production, that of the social character of production, the required ruling class and the social aspect of labor, and the private capitalist form of appropriation, which is, again, that material wealth produced by the workers being appropriated by a minority. So under capitalism, the capitalist class is the ruling class, and they dominate every sphere of society. We were just talking about it earlier. If you are having conversations with your family at dinner, in the headlines, at the museums, when you're looking at art, what it is, what you see is dominated by the capitalist ideology, essentially, from art and culture to politics and governance. The growth of working class resistance has expedited the growth of bourgeois ideas and, I guess, establishing these institutions, but rather strengthening these institutions and strengthening these ideas. And with that, alongside the reactionary domestic and foreign policy of the ruling class, the state machinery, including the armed forces and other instruments of coercion and suppression, these have also grown. So this is where we're going to get a little fun with it. And we're going to take a moment to look at examples of how the ruling class, again, the capitalist class, has permeated the spiritual life of society to uphold the spirit of capitalism. I actually just have one example here. Some of you might recognize this, some of you might know who this is. This is an artwork by Jackson Pollock, who was an artist at the forefront of the abstract expressionist movement. And upon first look, one would think that this art, specifically this painting, but also this painting, is very representative of, you know, a lot of the work that he has made. One might think that this seems very apolitical. You know, after all, it's just a canvas with paint splatter on it. So the abstract expressionist movement from the 30s to the 50s comprises of artists who created works characterized by fields of colors and shapes and the sorts of like gestural expressions of these colors and shapes, which represents the artist's processes and also the artist's own individual expression, you know, essentially through this type of art, they're imprinting their own self-expression into their art. And the artists associated with this movement became known as the first wave of artists to pioneer a uniquely American modern art, which is important because thus abstract expressionism was seen as carrying the American spirit. Now, again, this is from the 30s to 50s, but the height of abstract expressionism was around the 40s and 50s, late 40s. So not only did the movement sweep the US by storm, but it skyrocketed to international publicity and popularity as well. And the timeline of this popularity aligned with the US's Cold War aggression against the USSR and communism, you know, worldwide. And so again, you have this art movement that permeates throughout American culture domestically, but also there's shows and exhibitions and it's being published in foreign and international magazines and so forth. And it's all over the place. I'm just gonna move forward to a picture of Jackson Pollock himself at work. So years later, after the height of it, it was revealed through research from different historians that the CIA had actually funded multiple platforms which endorsed and promoted the abstract expressionist movement abroad, and specifically including, you know, completely funding a British American cultural journal called Encounter, which was a huge proponent of this abstract expressionist movement. And this journal was, you know, based in London. One historian and journalist named Frances Stoner Saunders found through her research that the CIA had been funding the promotion of abstract expressionism in the international sphere for about 20 years, including the funding and organizing of some international exhibitions. So why would they do this? I mean, why would the CIA want to promote a very seemingly apolitical art? Well, one, I mean, I think because of the fact that it is apolitical, or it seems apolitical, right? So on the domestic front, to get people not thinking about their conditions, to get people thinking about individual self-expressionism, and that's what the American spirit is all about, you see that movement become really popular because of those concepts. But then two, abroad, that same concept of individual freedom is promoted as something, you know, anti-USSR, anti-Soviet communism, and so forth. So, I mean, even this picture of Jackson Pollock, I like it because has a cigarette in his mouth. He's standing in front of work that he produced. His clothes are a little rugged, and he, you know, a little dirty from the labor that he was engaged in. And he seems like a common man that people can relate to. He's a representative of a type of working man, and that, you know, related to a lot of people. So to this extent, with a growing resistance of the working class, you know, we see bourgeois institutions promoting their ideas through different cultural means, such as, you know, Jackson Pollock's art or other art, not just him. But with that came the growing resistance of the working class and their own ideologies and what they did, what working class people do to kind of not perpetuate the capitalist spirit, essentially. So now we're gonna look at some art that does not, I would say, serve the interests of the capitalist class in the same way, because at the end of the day, the art world is kind of run by the ruling class. This artist is Kathy Kollwitz. I couldn't help but, you know, put her in this presentation because she's one of my favorite artists, and I think that she's a really good representative of what it means to be an artist for the working class, and of the working class as well. So she has this beautiful quote here. She said, "I felt that I have no right to withdraw from the responsibility of being an advocate. It is my duty to voice the sufferings of men, the never-ending sufferings heaped mountain high." So Kathy Kollwitz was a German artist active during the interwar periods in Germany, as well as during the wars. I actually believe she passed away in 1945. And in an art world dominated by men, she created a presence for herself as an advocate for the working class, and with much of her subject matter focused on the experience of women during this period. And so for further context, her husband was a doctor and actually ran a clinic which treated mostly workers and people in need generally. And it was in this same clinic that Kathy Kollwitz had her studio for her art practice. So she saw a lot of his patients come in with, you know, their everyday struggles, their illnesses and ailments, and what they were able to deal with and what they couldn't deal with as well, what was accessible to them and what wasn't accessible to them, and getting to know these patients as her community. Additionally, her and her husband's son was killed in World War I. And so she spent a long period of her practice exploring mourning and motherhood. So this next series is a really striking representation of the grief of mothers. And it's very emotional. So I took this picture when I went to the Museum of Modern Art in New York in the summer. They had a whole exhibition on her, and I was super excited about it because I was not expecting it. And again, she's my favorite artist. But it was a very, very emotional experience seeing these works in person. So these are some close-ups of some of these. These are woodcut prints. And the series depicts, again, mourning and motherhood during wartime, essentially. And it's very relevant to what we see a lot of people dealing with right now in Lebanon and Palestine. It's super, super relevant and very poignant. And not only is the subject matter itself about working class women, but the means that she chose to create her art is a very working class means. I mean, these are woodcut prints. These are reproducible. She creates it once and it kind of lasts forever, and it's accessible. It could be used to create more and more prints. And she was also politically active. I mean, you know, creating art like the series that we just saw was in a way being politically active. But this is a poster that she created. It says, "Down with the abortion paragraphs." And so her political activity came with issues around family planning and women's rights. And she created this poster to protest against paragraph 218 of the German Criminal Code, which made abortion illegal. So there's a difference that we see between, you know, art that is used to uphold, again, that bourgeois, that capitalist spirit, and then art that's used to be a proponent for the working class. And, you know, the latter feels a lot more, not to say that Jackson Pollock's like expressionism does not feel humane, but this is very upfront about the issues that the working class has to deal with. And working class art does not always have to be like that, but these are some really beautiful examples from Kathy Kolbitz that I really want to share with everyone. And yeah, again, it all comes back to working people are the real makers of history, and artists do have a role to play. Here are a couple other artworks. I mean, there are so many artists, and I know this is not an art talk, so I didn't want to get too into it. But these are some other artists if you want, or artworks if you want to jot them down. Diego Rivera is a popular one already, but this mural specifically is his Detroit industry mural at the Detroit Institute of Art. And it depicts auto factory workers on the job, and it's beautiful. And then we also have this art here by Mariana T. Alagwe. And this is actually a painting, really vibrant with the colors and everything. And a lot of her subject matter is about immigrant workers on the job, or they'll be with family, but it's predominantly around the working class. And so she does a really great job with that. So I would encourage people to look into some of this art, and maybe even when, if we have time for questions and comments, maybe even sharing some more artists you might be aware of. So yeah, and if you are an artist yourself, I mean, this is a great time to think about what ways can your art help be a proponent of the working class spirit, and not perpetuate the capitalist ideologies. Okay. So back to the socioeconomic formation and the concepts here. So from capitalism, we do see, well, we hope to see, but that what historical materialism tells us is the transition from capitalism will be into socialism and communism. So the large scale machine production, those huge factories, plants, mines, all that we saw rise in capitalism, in addition to the social character of production that we saw come from capitalism, these are the prerequisites to being able to transition into that socialism, communist, socioeconomic formation. And in this formation, the private capitalist ownership transitions into public ownership, in which that majority of the working people own the means of production. So we see here the working class seizes political power and forms the means of production to be publicly owned. And this is kind of the cliffhanger I'm going to end this part one with, so we have enough time for comments and questions, but the means of production belong to the working people, and the relations of production assume the nature of cooperation and mutual assistance between workers, free of exploitation. And so when we cover part two in December, we'll elaborate more on what this looks like and what the prerequisites are for that transition into the communist socioeconomic formation, and then what the role of the working class is, you know, with where we're at today and the labor movement. So I'm looking forward to it. And if we want to hear, if anyone wants to comment on what more they'd like to see, I think that would be nice to hear as well. So we're at about 11:30 Eastern my time. I think we can take comments and questions now.
Okay, thank you, Danielle. We're opening the floor for comments and questions. Unfortunately, as usual, we cannot read anything you write in the questions box. So please feel encouraged to share your comment or question verbally. Again, this is Dee Miles, and I will facilitate the or moderate the question and answer period. So please feel encouraged to join in the development of this topic. Jeremy, your mic is open on our end.
Well, can you guys hear me? This is my first time ever talking with you guys. Thank you for the opportunity. I'm not a member. I'm more of a third generation Oregonian. But I think it's, I thank you for letting me learn more about your party. I have a lot of questions. Well, my main question, what is the location in Portland? You know, when you try to learn about that, it seems to not really have a location. And then, like a lot of my background understanding of the 20th century of the group is really interesting.
Jeremy, yes. You have, email me at dee@cpusa.org for any questions that are not related to this subject matter. So you can.
I do have questions on the subject matter.
Both of those, great.
Okay. When it comes to like reform, you know, against the capitalist system, what will that take? I guess when in the past there's been a lot of like Noam Chomsky. I'm having a hard time remembering the names right now. Of economic reform related to that versus kind of like what's happening a lot is these Marxist terms are being confused by people outside of the party. And so like I guess maybe I should just write to you, I guess. I don't mean to interrupt the discussion on a tangent.
No, give your input related to the subject matter and then whatever now and then whatever else you want to share, just send me an email.
So like, you know, the Brooke-Wood Agreement started like in World War II, and that really was the standard of, you know, the value of the US dollar and, you know, how it influenced. And like the labor movement has always been, you know, multi-layered, and some support changing the system and some doesn't, I guess. And so like the art was really interesting to see. I mostly have a lot of like magazines from the 20th century, you know, on different, and I'm trying to understand more about, I guess I need to write to you. I'm sorry to kind of go on my own. Thank you for the opportunity of talking.
Thank you, Jeremy. Look forward to your email.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, we're looking for raised hands. We're looking for raised hands. Please feel encouraged to participate in the conversation. Nicole, your mic is open.
Hi, this Danielle. That was really fascinating. Now I'm going to look up the artists. I was wondering, now in the tech era, how we deal with controlling workers controlling the means of production, say, in things like social media, where there's lots of workers, say, maybe doing the coding and doing all that kind of stuff. How can this happen to take place?
Thank you, Nicole. Okay, Nathaniel, we're opening your mic.
Hey there. Thanks for having this session. I appreciate it. I just had a quick question about the, maybe I had just missed it in the art part. Does the book cite its sources for, this is, I guess, a technical question, but, and maybe it's just skepticism in general, but I'd like to know, does it cite its sources for the CIA's involvement in giving it? I do, you know, I like to believe it at face value, but I'd also like to dig into that a little bit. So I was just curious if the book had that out there.
Thank you, Nathaniel. Now I may butcher your name, but Nuria.
Hi, thank you very much. I'd like to know what kind of art you think might be hanging in the mansions of the oligarchs right now, since you're looking at the working class art. What do you think is going on art-wise in the homes of the ruling class right now? What kind of art are they choosing to look at?
Thank you, Nuria.
Thank you.
Let's go back to the presenter, Danielle, for now, and then we'll come back for more comments and questions. Danielle?
Well, yeah, thank you everyone for your comments and questions. I think these are really great questions, so I'm excited to give my input on them. I think it was Nicole who had the question around how in the tech era, I think it was on how tech workers can control the means of production regarding tech. And so just to elaborate on this, you know, we have to work towards, I work in IT currently, and it's a very exploitative like industry. I mean, they all are, but it's, I'm working 60 hours a week and I'm working with people in India who are even more exploited. And it's really intense and it's a really scary industry to unionize in. But when it comes to the idea of controlling, you know, the means of production with tech, well, that has to be part of the broader working class movement towards that transition out of capitalism, right? So we have to be united with our fellow, I guess, working class peers and, you know, take part in the labor movement if we want to see real change also come into the tech industry as well. So there are some companies, tech workers that have been able to unionize with, you know, unions that aren't tech specific either, like the UAW, which is the auto workers union. They have some tech firms under, you know, they have some tech workers. And I think it really is about being a part and not being like siloed and being a part of the broader working class movement. And I hope that answers your question. I hope I wrote down your question correctly to be able to answer it. But yeah, it's the tech industry is very, you know, jarring and intimidating to be someone who's trying to work towards like that working class liberation. But I think it can be done if we unite with our fellow workers in other industries as well. The next question on the CIA involvement cited. So I don't know, I might not have been clear enough on this, but that was my input into the presentation. Afanasyev briefly covers like the aspect of culture and how, you know, these ideas and institutions with bourgeois ideology and the capitalist spirit are upheld through different aspects of spiritual life. And so I added in the art as an example. And the example around abstract expressionism being kind of, you know, used by the CIA, it wasn't created by the CIA. Like it wasn't like planted. Jackson Pollock wasn't planted. He really was just like an artist doing his thing, right? And so the point wasn't that like the CIA like planted this or anything like that, but once it was there, they didn't do it just with abstract expressionism. They did it with a lot of uniquely American art, right? And so they did fund exhibitions abroad. There's documentation of like the funding of journals that like promoted anti-communist journals, which would promote the art and so forth. And I did cite one historian who had researched this and came up with the statistic that it's been about 20 years that the CIA has been like doing this, because they didn't just do it with abstract expressionism. They did it with a lot of different American cultural components, bringing those abroad and funding them and funding museums even in New York and so forth that had these exhibitions for abstract expressionism. So I guess if you look at it from like a perspective of, and maybe you weren't, but just to clarify for everyone else in the room, if you look at it from the perspective that the CIA planted abstract expressionism, it definitely does sound a little crazy, maybe not that crazy, but we can definitely understand that the government had, and still to this day, has special interests in funding and seeing the promotion of art and other cultural elements that uphold, you know, like I've said before, the capitalist spirit and so forth. So I can, let's see, let me just pull up my notes so I can reread the journalist who had done research on this. There's a journalist and historian named Francis Stoner Saunders. And again, this is something that I just put into the presentation to make it a little more interesting so that we can, you know, look at different movements and artworks that might perpetuate capitalism and the capitalist ideologies over artworks that are more aligned to the working class values. And then there is a really interesting question, which I'm excited to answer. I think it was Nuria who asked about the art hanging in the mansions of oligarchs and, you know, what kind of art do they have? And let me tell you, they have this art. They have working class art hanging in their homes. I mean, one of the biggest contradictions here is you have something that is so relatable to, you know, people who are dealing with families suffering and dying because of wars, imperialist wars going on. And they see this at the Museum of Modern Art. Like, the contradiction there is so apparent. And it's the same thing with the homes and mansions of some of these art collectors. I mean, this is also art. I know for a fact, like, Mariana here, she sells through, like, her, she's represented by, like, a big gallery. And the only people buying that art from that big gallery are these, are, you know, people who are really wealthy. And, you know, collecting art is not like a cheap hobby. So when we, when it comes to that contradiction within the quote unquote art world, yeah, it's very apparent between the artists and the collectors, and then the workers in the arts as well, right? And so, because with museums and other organizations, art organizations being predominantly nonprofit, their funding comes a lot from, you know, like wealthy families in areas. Here in Detroit, we have the Illich family, which created Little Caesar's Pizza, and they fund a lot of the arts. Same with Dan Gilbert, who does Quicken Loans, funds a lot of the arts. And the people that they're funding are like working class people who have become artists. And so it is a really, I mean, that could be a presentation one day in and of itself. Like, the art that is being collected is also art that is like supposed to be proponents of the working class as well and represent the working class. And so it also brings the question, you know, where do we represent, where do we show art in public spaces? How are we funding these public spaces, and how are we making art accessible? Not just creating art that's for working people, but also making sure people can have access to art, working people. And so, yeah, that was a very interesting question, and I think brings up a really good point on the contradictions that are, you know, in the lives of artists and art collectors as well. And I think that's all. Those are all the questions so far, Dee.
All right. So we will go back to the asking for comments and questions. We're looking for raised hands. All right, Mercer.
Thank you. I like to share something. I'm glad that you focused on art. And I like to share something. I work in my capacity. I work with a person who wanted to make a personal statement about mental illness. And they, in their creative mind, they have created a series that they call the Walt Disney series, where they use Walt Disney figures to talk about mental illness. And I was concerned and wondering, wow, that's like, you know, this is a major brand. A major capitalist brand, and because I think they're, because of what they struggle with, they didn't make that connection. So I just wanted to share that, because I wish I had, could tell them something that could, I don't know, help them, give them something to think about. But the series is supposed to be very fascinating, but obviously they are encroaching on the brand of Walt Disney, but they're talking about something very personal to them, mental illness.
Thank you, Mercer. Looking for more raised hands. Sean.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you, Danielle. This is really great. So yeah, like you said, you know, it's not ideas that change society, but the other way around. And, you know, you talked about how the ruling class uses its controlled production to reinforce its dominant ideology, get people to accept and support the base structure of capitalism. So, you know, unfortunately, we can't art our way into a revolution. But, you know, clearly there is a, you know, a way that these two things relate to the class struggle. So my question is, what ways can we use elements of the superstructure, such as art and other cultural production, to advance the class struggle? Or to put it another way, how does the battle of ideas relate to the class struggle? Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sean. John, I see your hand is up again. We've opened the mic on your, on our end.
Hi, thank you. A very interesting presentation. Thank you very much. Yeah, I do know that the CIA's involvement in the art is well documented, and I think if the person does a Google on that, they'll find a lot of information. But I wondered what Danielle, who gave such a wonderful introduction here, slavery was shown as preceding feudalism in the image we saw, and I wonder how they would explain how slavery then emerged throughout the Western Hemisphere after the early stage of capitalism. How would the theorists explain the emergence of slavery after feudalism, after first putting it in as a stage before feudalism?
Okay, thank you, John. Okay, Danielle, we're turning the mic back over to you.
Oh, thank you. So there was one comment on the artist series around mental illness and utilizing Disney. I want to say thank you for your comment. I do think it is an interesting use of Disney, and I don't know the art or the artist, so it's hard for me to really say any more than that, but I will say that there are artists who have like reappropriated big brands and iconography for the use of, you know, being subversive or subverting it and criticizing it. And so for it sounds like with regards to your friend's case, it's a little more personal, but that's definitely like a thing that we've seen throughout the history of art and so forth and visual culture. And it's always been a really interesting dynamic. There was one person, I had a hard time catching names, but someone mentioned we can't art our way into a revolution. And I do appreciate the comment because it's true. I mean, no individual can really even work their way through a revolution, and no just an individual group of people either. I mean, it really needs to be us working together as the working class, every aspect of the working class. And so the question was, how can we use art and cultural elements to advance the class struggle? So I think, and we kind of briefly mentioned this earlier too, and I'll stick to the example of art, but I think it can be applied in other areas as well. Thinking of a single work of art just being put out there isn't really the best way to think of it, right? Like when you have a single work of art, you have everything that came before it and everything that's gonna come after it. It's an end-to-end process to create art, because not is it just created and then it just exists, but there needs to be the right conditions to create a work of art. And then there needs to be the right conditions to put it out there and for the artist's message to actually get across. And so it's an end-to-end process, and every aspect of that process, from the artist themselves having the conditions that they need to live and so forth, to getting their materials that they need and affording those materials. So a lot of artists have, you know, jobs on the side as well that are outside their art practice, to then creating their art and having the space to create their art, to then actually networking and being able to put their art somewhere, and then actually putting their art somewhere, and then the audience coming and across and being able to actually see the art and engage with the art. So there's this whole end-to-end process with every single work of art. And you want to think about in every step of that process, from the very beginning with just the artist to the indefinite end with the audience that engages with the art, how is it serving working class interests, and how is that, like, how are those steps, step by step, advancing the class struggle? I mean, if you are an artist who has a coffee shop job on the side, are you, you know, a steward at your union, or are you actively trying to unionize? And then how do you utilize your skills as an artist to contribute to that activity? If you're creating your artwork, are you thinking about, okay, I mean, we just talked about how this painting here on the bottom left might be hanging up in some rich guy's home. So what is the artist doing to ensure that the message that they want to get across is still the message that they want to get across when it's been, you know, kind of hidden somewhere and not really accessible to other people? How as artists can we make sure that our art is still serving the working class and also, you know, still communicating what we want to communicate? So where do we, and, you know, again, I studied art history and visual culture, so I didn't create a lot of my own art, but I do see this obligation in ensuring that public art is represented accurately and that there aren't messages skewed, because when you have the ruling class being the funders of the arts and the people who provide the space for the arts, they will change the messaging around the art. I mean, when you go to the DIA, the Detroit Institute of Arts, and you look at the Diego Rivera mural about the auto workers, there's not going to be a lot about like how any sort of indication about, you know, there's not going to be a promotion of, you know, we need to unionize our auto workers. Like they're not like, I mean, I think that this mural would go hand in hand with like Sean Fain going up and speaking about like the mural himself and the importance of continuing that like working class drive. And the Detroit Institute of Arts, they're not going to do that. So where can we make sure that those, that messaging, that interaction with the art in that way, that that's upheld? And I think, yeah, I mean, I think artists have a really important role to play in the class struggle. And I think, like I mentioned with tech workers earlier, we don't do these things in silos as individual. We contribute our skills. And then we also ensure that like the history that we're maintaining is our history and not let it get kind of washed out by the ruling class. So again, I think art and cultural elements, they have an end-to-end process to them. They have a life cycle to them. And it's about ensuring that that life cycle, if we want it to contribute to the class struggle, then we have to ensure it's throughout the process. And then there was other, I don't think I wrote this question down very thoroughly, so I might be missing some points here, but someone did ask how a theorist would explain the merging of slavery after feudalism. So I'm going to digress a bit, and I will say like this book will give you kind of like the tools and the terms that you need to answer that question. He does describe, you know, when we think about the socioeconomic formations and one kind of taking over another, that doesn't necessarily mean that all elements of that previous socioeconomic formation have been eliminated. They still kind of permeate throughout culture, and especially as you have like older generations and so forth. And that's not really getting specific to slavery. I think on the question of slavery specifically, I'll kind of defer to maybe our next presentation on it is something that we can talk about, because I do think that's a good question. And I just don't have like the details to parse it out right now. But again, like when we talk about socioeconomic formations taking over each other, we're not talking about like the complete elimination of those cultural and spiritual and economic aspects of like the previous socioeconomic formation. So I think that was a good point to bring up so that we can clarify that.
Okay, thank you, Danielle. I think Danielle is pointing to what Marx indicated as early capitalism found a use for prior relations of production to accumulate capital, to produce an accumulation of capital. And as Danielle indicated, she can expand on that topic December 22nd at 11 a.m. Eastern when we do part two of this session. So thank you everyone for participating this morning. And to the point of art, we hope that you all will produce a lot of art to help us navigate our way through the tragedy that we will face, that we are facing right now, to help us find joy in moments of misery, to help us exalt our very being as working class people, and reinforce the fact that we are not unable to make a contribution to this world, and in fact that the world relies on us to bring into being a new and more humane society, so art can help reinforce us in that endeavor. So we hope you will join us December 16th for the book talk on alienation, and we hope you will join us December 22nd for a continuation of this discussion. Thank you very much, Danielle, and thank you for utilizing your areas of expertise to help develop the many points that could be very boring without it. Thank you, and have a good day, everyone. Thank you for participating. Bye-bye.